school in geometry, which is six or something in the school in geometry. That's what we do here every semester. Before the actual talk, Sasha Abanov, who is the associate director of Simon Center, will introduce Simon Center, which provides our useful facilities.
Thank you. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Simon Center for Geometry and Physics. We are happy to host this workshop for the second time. The first one was 3 years ago. But I expect that many of you are new here to the Simon Center, so I'll just say a few words for a couple of minutes introducing the center. So the center is almost 10 years old. The building is 8 years old, and we are very proud of our building. But we are more proud of our faculty and postdocs. And on the math side, we have two faculty at this point, Kenji Fukai and Simon Donaldson, who probably do not need any introduction in this audience. And our important thing is, because there are many students here, I would like to say that we have 12 postdoctoral positions. Each of them is 3 years long. And that means that we hire every year 4 postdocs, 2 in physics and 2 in mathematics. Okay, so 2 mathematical postdoctoral positions. All information is on our website. Also, we have a lot of conferences, workshops, and programs running in math and physics running throughout the year. And all talks in Simon Center are recorded and posted on our video portal, which you can also find. There are pretty good talks, and quality of our video recordings is pretty high, so you can use it as a resource. And that's basically what I wanted to say, and welcome to the center, and I hope you will have a very productive workshop. Thank you.
So one thing Sasha did not say, because he's very polite, but I will, is that there are big signs
entrance to the room saying no food or drink. Please make sure you read them and please try to follow them. So you are most welcome to have coffee outside, but please don't bring it here because it tends to spill on somebody else's back. And with that, we're very pleased to have Mihai Paun from University of Illinois at Chicago, who will talk about positivity of push forwards of pluricanonical shifts.
Thank you. I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation. It's really a great pleasure and honor to be here today. So let me start by set up some notations and tell you what would be somehow our primary targets. So first of all, we'll consider P from x to y would be an algebraic fiber space. And then, so x and y are supposed to be smooth projective over the complex numbers, and the fibers of this map are connected. Then projective manifold, one of the most basic and important invariant is the Cordaria dimension, which I will denote by kappa of x. So this will be the Cordaria dimension. Of x. And then another notation which I would like to set up here would be the one of the canonical bundle associated to this map. So let's say omega x over y. This would be the relative canonical bundle which is none other than omega x twisted with the inverse image omega y dual. Okay, I'll try to follow to respect these notations during all my talk. And then in this setup, an important problem was formulated by Itaka a few years ago. So the conjecture is as follows. So in this context, kappa of x is at least as big as kappa of y plus kappa of f, where f is the generic fiber of the algebraic fiber space f. Okay, So what I would like to present to you today would be a particular case of this conjecture, which in which the analytic methods have a very maybe small but decisive impact. So the results I would like to discuss today would be the following. So assume. So let's Fm be the push forward of the relative canonical boundary tensor M, and then assume that the determinant of this torsion field coherent sheaf is topologically trivial. So C1 of Fm equals to zero. So this, let's say, star inequality follows. Then star follows. So that would be one result obtained by Eugenio and Cao and myself a couple of years ago. And then maybe the second one would be the fact that star holds true, provided that the dimension of the base is at least at most 2. Dimension of y is at most 2. So the content of the result of Juni and Zhao here is that, in fact, this holds for surfaces, right? Because for curves, this was known long ago by Kawamata. Now, needless to say that this problem attracted a lot of interest and many important contributions due to maybe Fujita, then Kawamata, Collard, and Fiveg. The methods that they use were mostly algebraic. So what I would like to explain to you today is that a study of this sheaf from the metric point of view, as a consequence, we can get a little bit farther in the particular cases we understand in this context. In particular, this holds for Y an abelian variety. So somehow I will not give any serious proof in what will follow, but I will try just to outline the main steps, the main ideas, and techniques which kind of leads to these statements. So the plan of the talk will be as follows. The first part. The first part, I'll recall the construction of canonical metrics on this bundle and its direct image. So construction. Of canonical metrics. On FM. And well, on rather on omega. X relative twisted with a line bounded and its direct image so it's pushed forward via the map P. Then I will recall very very quickly a few notions around the singular Hermitian metrics on vector boundaries and torsion-free sheaves. So maybe here a good title would be flatness criteria for singular Hermitian vector boundaries or sheaves, or torsion-free sheaves. And then in the third part, I will just sketch the main ideas of the statements there. Of the proof for the statements on the blackboard. Above. Okay. Right, so this is somehow what I'll try to explain to you next. And let's see. So somehow in the first part, and maybe to a large extent, the second one was already discussed during the mini school this morning. So I only try to say very quickly what were the main constructions and results. And then, so let's see. So, still as a matter of notation, if we have a line bound over a manifold X, and then H L is a singular metric on L. So this simply means that locally HL is given by, so in the trivialization of Lie bounded, this is given by absolute value square, which is the standard Lie bounded standard metric that you have on some trivialization open set, times exponential minus phi L, which is the so-called weight of the function. Now, in the classical the classical definition that you learn in school is that this phi L is smooth, but for our purposes here, we will allow this to be singular. But we just want it to be good enough so that we can define curvature current, so that phi L will be in general in L1 log on some open set, let's say U. And then the curvature of such an object would be simply given by IDD bar phi L. So this one would be the curvature of L restricted to the open set U with respect to the metric HL. So, but of course, this is just some L1 log function, so then this does not really make sense to take the IDD bar operator. But what you can do is that to give a meaning of this in a weak sense, and this is what the curvature becomes. Differential forms with the measure coefficients, if in some good cases. So usually we assume that phi L is a pluricanonical harmonic on U. Now, here, if I understood correctly, most of you have algebraic geometry training and interests. So the point is that this class of functions, so for example, a good example of pluricanonical harmonic function is a logarithm. For example, phi is logarithm of some of the absolute value squares. This one belongs to the pluricanonical harmonic class. So it's if those are holomorphic on omega, then we get such an object. So somehow here, and in general, given sections, there is the correspondence in the case of line bundles, given sections on L or some of its multiples, then there is a correspondence between those objects and the matrix on L with positive curvature current. Okay, so somehow this correspondence here between sections of multiples of a line bundle and the metrics on L has exploited in many instances in algebraic geometry and turned out to be very successful. And somehow, if you look at what I try to explain here, is still a manifestation of this process, the interplay between sections and metrics, which will lead us to the proof of this result. Now, so let's see. We have so in the same notations as here. So let's define f, the push forward of the relative conical bundle, twisted with L, and the multiple ideal sheaf corresponding to the metric L. So this is just this is a coherent sheaf on the manifold X. The stalk at some point is the holomorphic functions which are L2 with respect to this weight, with respect to the local weight of the metric. And then I want to define some way of constructing some way of I want to define an inner product term on F. So given let's say that we are given S1 and S2 local sections of F. Yes.
Do you think you could write about twice as big?
Yes, I can try for a while, but then it will shrink
again. Okay, so.
All right, let's see. So let's see. Given S1 and S2 in the space of sections of F over some open subset V. So here V is inside. Y, so let's say a small coordinate set. Small coordinate subset. Then I want to define I want to find a way to define a scalar product between the S1 and S2. Okay, so in such a way that it should be geometrically meaningful. So I mean, I want this one to have some nice properties at the end of the day. So one way of doing this is by duality, if you want. So let's say that we take phi, which is a smooth function with a support in V, and then So let's define also, let's say U I is S I wedge the inverse image of dt, where t is the coordinate on V, and then this is a U I's. Is a local section of so over pi inverse of V and the omega x twisted with L and with a multiple ideal sheaf here. So then I will define this function, the scalar product of the two sections, by using this correspondent sections of the canonical bundle as follows. So I want the integral over V of my test function times the function you want to define with respect to, let's say, the Lebesgue measure here, d mu with respect to this coordinate I'm fixing. So this is simply, so by definition, the integral over inverse image of V. So here I have phi composed with a p times u1 wedge u2 bar expansion minus phi l, where this is here there is a unimodular constant, which let me just denote it by cn. So here is the quantity I want to define, and then here is something that I know, right? Because those are top forms on X. When you take U1 wedge U2 bar, this is this is a form of degree 2 times. So if we put some dimensions here, if x is of dimension, let's say n plus k, fibering over y, which is of dimension k, then this is a form of type n plus k, which we can integrate, so we get a number. And then, so this defines, by duality, this is defined almost everywhere. Okay. So this defines the scalar product S1, S2 as a function on V. So on V, of course, it's only defined almost everywhere, right? Because of this, because of the way we introduce this function. So the point is that let's denote this by H. So the point is that in this way the sheaf F becomes somehow endowed. So with a singular metric Hermitian metric H, so again defined by this procedure. Now the theory of singular metrics on line bounders is like I tried to recall very briefly. They are very very well known and very well developed. Now for the vector bounders and more general for torsion free sheaves, this is not quite the case. Among one of the few articles dedicated to this, I would mention the one by Marc De Cataldo, who did this in one of his previous lives, shortly after he finished his high school. But the notion which we introduce here is a little bit more general and somehow tailored to what we want to prove here. Okay. So here, a remark right away is that on a large open set so a subset of Y, so this is defined pointwise. So we simply identify omega relative to x, the restriction to the fiber of this is simply omega xy, and then our sections there. So we simply the norm of the scalar product between s1 and s2 at the point y is simply the integral of the fiber of s1 wedge s2 bar with the same constant. Well, okay, let me put c prime n because it's not the same as that one, but this, let's ignore this thing. So up to some unimodular constant is s1 wedge s2 bar exponential minus phi l restricted to the fiber xy. Well, it's automatic. Okay, so as you see from this expression, the scalar product I'm defining here can easily be plus infinity, right? Because of this is allowed to be singular. Okay, and then also is not defined everywhere because I want to avoid the points y where the fiber is singular. So in this case, so this is what we will call a bit later on a singular Hermitian metric. This has a few good properties, a few flaws, but still one can work with it. This is what I'm trying to explain you here. All right, maybe I move here. Oh, can I use those blackboards as well?
Yes, if you write black.
Okay. Now the result about this, so the theorem is that in fact H is a positively curved singular Hermitian metric on F. So in some particular case, this result was established by Takayama and myself. The version which we have here is due to Christian Schnell and Michna Popa and Christopher Haken. And then somehow, before going into the detail of, before explaining to you what is this notion in general, let me just say that what does it mean in this situation. So for any section, let's say G defined on V, and for any section of the dual of this sheaf, the function log of the norm of G with respect to the dual metric H star, the square here, is pluricanonical harmonic on V. Okay, so somehow the analog of this result, if the metric would be smooth, would be that this sheaf is positively curved in the sense of Griffiths. So this is the analog of Griffiths positivity . Okay, so we talk about positively curved, even if in general for a singular Hermitian metric, we do not have the manageable notion of curvature current, as in the case of the rank one bundle. Now, the main tool which we use in the proof of this result is the following theorem. Main technical tool in the proof. Is the following version of Osawa Takegoshi theorem due to Blotsky. So if we are giving ourselves,
yes. Might be very hard to see because of
okay. So, like I was about to say, the main technical tool in order to prove this result. I mean, Haken, Popa, and the following. So, given
section two
in Fy, which is none other than H star of xy and omega xy, tensor with L, and L2 with respect to that. This belonging to the ideal sheaf, then there exists, let's say. Okay, and then we fix ourselves B inside Y, which is the disk, and centered. Then there exists an extension which not of, let's say, pi inverse of D, and omega x over y, such that two things, so that you restricted to the single fiber is you, and then the one of the the unit disk, to avoid some constants, 1 over pi times the integral over the disk of the norm of u square exponential minus phi l is less than the norm of u. Okay, so one can extend the section, the canonical section we have on the central fiber in a neighborhood in such a way that the norm of the extension is controlled by 1 over pi. So here, the pi is simply the area of the unit disk, as you certainly know. But the point is that version of this result, they were known before, but with the bigger constants here. And what really matter in the proof of the that theorem is this optimal version. So again, this is due to speaking of Lotsky. Okay, now the point is that we have a pluricanonical version of this. So when we consider Fm is the push forward of the relative canonical to the power m. And then we would like to formulate a similar result as the one there, to have a metric on it with respect to which this one is positively curved. And then the first observation is that if we are given ourselves a section u in h naught of xy and omega xy to the power m, then we can associate, define a semi-norm here, the norm of u, semi-norm of u, as you want to call it, L2 over m square is by definition the integral over the fiber, so u to the power 2 over m exponential minus phi L. Well, there's no exponential minus phi L, excuse me. And this one to the power m. Okay, so at the point y, we can mimic what happened in the case m equal to 1, but the point is that the natural norm in the case m equals to 1 becomes this semi-norm here. Becomes a semi-norm in this pluricanonical context, and then we can define a metric on. So somehow the pluricanonical version is a little bit more involved in the sense that we first have to define a metric on the relative canonical bundle, which takes into account the sections of on each fiber, so very roughly things are done like this. So this will give us a metric on relative canonical bundle. So basically induced by the sections of H naught, well, of omega x over y to the power m. So somehow if we are giving ourselves a vector, let's say xi, in the dual, omega x over y dual, then I want to measure the norm of this one, well, the norm of xi at some point x square would be the supremum of So psi is an element in the dual of this. So it acts on sections of the relative canonical. So if I take this to the power m, I can have him acting on the sections I have here to the power, let's say, 2 over m. Well, so the norm of u, L2 over m, is at most 1. OK, so we can introduce this way of measuring the size of a vector by duality and by using the fiber sections of what we have here. And then, so the next step in the construction of a metric here is to realize that, in fact, omega relative is to the power m is can be written like tensor with Lm, where Lm is omega relative to the power m minus 1. So this is one of the Yum Tong Siu favorite jokes, like saying that m equals 1 plus m minus 1. That is true. But the point is that this one already has a metric which I described here, given by the sections of the guide. And then we can apply the previous construction and get a metric on the push forward of this. So by the previous construction, so we get a metric, a singular Hermitian metric on the push forward on FM. Okay, so again, the construction of the metric in a pluricanonical case is somehow a bit of a detour, right? We first understand how to use the fiber wall section of this bundle in order to construct the metric on the relative canonical, and then by using that, once we get that metric with the right curvature properties, which is what we have here, then a singular metric on FM is using the fact that we know how to do the construction for the adjoint in the adjoint case, and it has the same similar curvature properties. Okay, so somehow this is what I wanted to say about the first part. Maybe here just a remark. So the positivity, so the all right. So let's say the existence of a metric on the FM with semi-positive curvature. So this one implies the results of feedback concerning the weak semi-positivity of these sheaves. So the weak semi-positivity of FM. So I remind you that this is the algebraic geometry notion corresponding to the pseudo-effectivity in the case of line bundles. So somehow having this metric, which is semi-positively curved, implies the results that one proof in algebraic geometry, which happen to be relevant in the context of the CNM conjecture. Now, of course, a very interesting question would be to understand something about the converse of this. Once you have the algebraic geometry properties of this kind of sheaf, can one construct a metric? Not so clear so far. Anyway. Okay. Now let me say something about a singular Hermitian metric in the context of vector bundles. So this will be the second part of the talk. So here the context is as follows. So we have E, which is the vector bundle. And we want to formulate a notion of singular Hermitian metric, which kind of looks like the one we have here on our main example. And then the situation would be the thing to do would be to say that so that a singular Hermitian metric on E, so is a function that associates to each point x on the base. So here I'm only considering this one over a complex manifold. It's not necessarily the one in the previous part of the talk. Now, for each x, we have Hermitian inner product to 0 and infinity, which is the so-called singular Hermitian inner product what do I mean by that? So this would have the same properties as the usual one, except that I allow the value 0 and infinity. Okay, so it satisfies the homogeneity. It satisfies the triangular inequality. It satisfies the parallelogram rule, so that it comes from inner product. But some vectors, some non-zero vectors, may go to zero. Some other ones may go to infinity. And if you look at the formulas which were on the blackboard here and there, you see that this, I'm really forced to do that, because the most natural metric that I have at hand on these kind of sheaves, they would naturally have a value plus infinity somewhere. So I want this to be a singular Hermitian inner product for each point, and I want moreover that so that the for any section of E over some open set U, so the norm of S with respect to my metric should be measurable. Okay, and what else do I want? Well, I want also that Hx is finite and positive almost everywhere. So I allow the metric to degenerate in some places, but almost everywhere on the manifold, this should be an honest inner product, namely positive and finite. And then, so the definition is that E endowed with this kind of object here is semi-positive in the sense of Griffiths, if and only if, for any local sections of the dual, the log of the norm square is plusible monic. So any, let's say, G in gamma of U and E dual, so the log of the norm of G square with respect to the H star is plusible monic. Okay, so somehow we want to formalize here the properties that naturally that were natural in the setup of push forward of the adjoint bounders in this situation. And if you look at the way we have defined the scalar product here, you will see that that in fact fits into this framework. Okay, so we have that. So given F, which is the torsion-free sheaf, coherent, of course, on our manifold X, then we denote by X of F inside X, which is the open set where this one is locally free. we say that this can be dealt with a metric having semi-positive curvature if the restriction of F to this open set has one. So the corresponding notion for F is done by considering the restriction of F to the loci where this one has is locally free. Okay. So now, as we saw this morning, and there is somehow a big absent in this picture, namely the curvature tensor himself. So if we have a line bundle endowed with a singular metric, then the curvature tensor, the curvature form, so this is a 1-1 form with, so okay, which is semi-positively curved, excuse me. So with the measure coefficients. Now the problem is that in this degree of generality for a vector bundle endowed with the metric, even if when the semi-positivity of the curvature condition is realized, we do not have such an object. So you would like to say that okay, now I have a line, vector bundle E endowed with a metric like that, which is semi-positive in the sense of Griffiths, as I recall there. Then you would like to say that that one can cook up some curvature current, which would be a vector-valued 1-1 form with measure coefficients. Well, this is not true. This is simply not true. And there is an example due to Hossein Raufi, which is which you can have some fun computing. So if the metric H is like 1 plus z square, z and z bar, and absolute value of z square, then for this example, what you see is that if you compute the curvature by the usual formula, then the coefficients, one of the coefficients outside the diagonal will be a Dirac distribution, which marks a really important difference. So it will be a distribution higher order, it will not be a measure. Okay, so you will see a Dirac delta here when you compute the curvature. But nevertheless, we do have some situations when this does not occur, and this is what I would like to discuss next. So the proposition. Now, let's assume that EH has a semi-positive curvature. So this is, a singular Hermitian metric, in the sense I've given here, with semi-positive curvature, such that the metric induced, so the determinant of H, is, let's say, smooth. Let's say bounded, okay? In the sense, let me write it in a very imprecise way, like this. So I want the metric on the determinant. So this one is the metric on the determinant of E, on the top of E. I want this one to be bounded and finite, to be positive and finite on X. Then one can define the curvature of E with respect to H will be this would be a vector value current, 1-1 current, which has measure coefficients. Now, if you remember how do we compute the curvature for a vector bundle or for a line bundle, you see that at some point there is a d. It's a h minus 1 dh, where H is the matrix corresponding to the metric we have here, and then the condition on the determinant to be bounded between the two constants here, of course, has an influence on the fact on the way you compute the inverse of this matrix, right? So somehow it's somehow believable that if you know something about the determinant, things are getting much better, right? This one combined with the positivity of the curvature. Now, the what I would like to discuss next is the so-called flatness criteria. So, let's say proposition. So let's say that as before, so we have E, H, singular Hermitian, vector bundle. Over a complex manifold, and such that is positively curved in the sense of Griffiths, and such that the above condition is better than verify like this, such that the C1 of the determinant of E, well, okay. What I want to say here, so this one would be on a compact manifold. Now, such that the first, so C1 of E is topologically trivial. So, I mean, zero. Then, E is flat. So, is flat in the usual in the usual sense if. So the metric is smooth and the curvature equals to zero. And then this also applies to torsion-free sheaves. If you replace this E by torsion-free sheaf, you have the same properties here. This is still well defined in that context, and the conclusion is that it is flat, where is at the point where is a vector bundle, namely outside codimension two set. Now, like I already mentioned in the paper by Hagenpapa and Schnell, they obtain a generalization of this proposition. If the sheaf in question has the so-called minimal extension property, then it is locally free on the whole manifold and flat in the usual sense. Okay, so let me say a few words about the proof of this result. Well, in the first place, since this one is zero, this means that the determinant of H is smooth. Okay, so in particular, this condition is absolutely verified here, and then there exists a curvature current. So by the proposition before, so the curvature current is, yes?
Why is the determinant of H smooth if C1 is 0?
Well, because let's see here, just a word of explanation. Yeah, so X is the compact, and then the determinant of H is endows E, so the determinant of E endowed with this metric, this is semi-positively curved, and then since the C1 is zero, this means that the Hessian of this is zero, so the determinant of H locally, so on some open set, is exponential minus some function psi, and then this one would correspond to a positive current, but C1 of the current in question is zero. So this means that the current in question is zero. So so IDD bar psi is zero, and then of course this being an elliptic operator, psi is becomes smooth right away. Okay. Yes, this was my next sentence. Spoiler. Okay. So as Dror just said, So here the determinant being smooth, in particular, we have a curvature current. So locally this means that locally, so that the curvature of each H can be written like I'll write here some symbols. I'll explain in a moment. So C ij bar alpha beta bar. Dzi which dzj bar e alpha tensor beta dual. This is the expression of the curvature current for a vector boundary. So it's a 1-1 form with values in the endomorphism of e. And then somehow the content of the previous proposition is that those are positive, those are measures. And then the curvature of the determinant of E is simply the trace here. So it will be the sum of Cij alpha alpha bar, so the sum for alpha and then the sum for I and j. Dzi wedge dzj bar. So what we do know is that all the this one, on the other hand, this one equals to zero. Now the positivity condition that we have, so we know that the positivity in the sense of Griffith implies another condition of what you have in a smooth case for those measures, and this would imply that each of them is zero. Cij bar, alpha beta bar, is zero. So this is a consequence of the Griffith positivity. Somehow, to have a very simple-minded idea in hand, what I'm about to tell you here is that you have a matrix which is positive, semi-positive defined, such that the trace is zero. Well, if the trace is zero, then all the coefficients are zero, right? So that's what it is. Okay, so once you know that the curvature is zero, so if the curvature of E h equals zero, so this implies that h is smooth, right? Because it's basically the higher rank generalization of this. You have some elliptic equation satisfied by the coefficients of the metric, and then you deduce the smoothness by elliptic regularity, basically. So this is simply elliptic regularity. Okay? So excuse me, do you have a question? You seem to have a lot of fun. So. Excuse me? Okay. So all right, then it's smooth for very simple reasons. Okay, then all right, so let me move on the other blackboard. So somehow this is what basically what I wanted to explain to you about the theory of singular Hermitian metrics on the vector boundaries. The main problem is the absence of the curvature tensor, but we do have a criteria which sometimes works, which is this one. Once the determinant is bounded, then necessarily we do have such an object which allow us to to establish the flatness of the Hermitian vector bundles for which the first Chern class is zero and which are positive in the sense of Griffiths. Okay. Let me see if there's something else I wanted to tell you here. Excuse me?
How this relates to the
Chicago problem. Exactly. Exactly. I'll come to this in 1 second. So, yeah. Let me erase here. So now let me come to the main applications. So, and to start with, let me start with the following. So that would be the third part of the application to a few particular cases of Ithaca conjecture. So the following, let me first discuss the following theorem. So let P from X to A be algebraic Faber space over an abelian variety then the codera of X is greater than the codera of the fiber. Okay, so let me try to convince you that the results I tried to explain to you a few seconds ago can be useful in this context. So for the proof, again, I followed the paper by Christian. So now, what I like about their proof is that it somehow mix the algebraic geometry results and with a small input from the analysis in order to derive this inequality. So the main points of the proof are as follows. Main steps. So the first one is that the first one is that it is enough to consider the case where kappa of x equals to zero. Okay, so there is a procedure saying that if you are able to deal with this case, then the general statement follows. So yeah, and the second one would be that if in this context, FM, which is the direct image of omega x over A, but here omega is trivial, so I just put it like this. So this one is a unipotent indecomposable vector bundle. So this thing means the following. So there is a composition series like as follows. So zero, which equals E zero inside E one, and so forth. E, let's say K, which is FM, such that the successive quotients are trivial, such that E I divided by E I minus one is the structural shift of the abelian variety A. Okay, those two facts were established in the context of algebraic geometry. Then let me come now to the how do we conclude from here? Well, it's absolutely immediate, right? So the third part is that, well, if the push forward has this property. I mean, yeah, indecomposable means that you cannot write it as a sum of two such a direct sum of two such objects. So the determinant of Fm is trivial. I mean, topologically trivial, the first chain class of Fm is zero, because of course every quotient here, it is the case. And then since this one has is semi-positively definite, semi-positive in the sense of Griffiths, the result I just explained to you tells us that in fact Fm is flat. Okay, and endowed with a smooth metric, so it's flat in the usual sense. And of course, this thing tells you immediately that you get Fm is trivial. Fm itself is trivial simply because okay, simply because if you have a section, if you have a map from Fm to O, then this one splits. Okay, so we have this result that so you see somehow the flatness of F. So here you have a zero curvature, but on the other hand, this map gives you a section of the dual. So this is exactly the reason why the map splits, if you want. And this is simply the end of the proof, because okay, so the part where analysis was helpful was exactly here to say that this property automatically implies that the push forward is trivial. So this would give you the fact that the canonical of the fiber equals to zero, right? Has coderia zero. Okay, somehow. So I still have like 20 minutes, right? So the next result would be the thing I stated before, so that we have a map from X to Y such that C1 of Fm is topological is equal to zero. Then let's see how to infer that CNM conjecture holds. The Ithaca conjecture holds. So here in this setting, again we use the fact if C1 of M of Fm is trivial, then Fm is flat. And then we argue as follows. So by analyzing the quaderia dimension here, so we analyze the following cases. So the first one being if quaderia dimension of y equals to zero, Then the result is basically more or less a consequence of what I already explained, together with the result due to Kang Zuo, so that the resulting question is as follows. So here this one Fm gives a representation of pi 1 of x into the unitary group of, let's say, rank R, Paun of Y, excuse me. And then by a result of Kang Zuo, this one is splits, is a direct sum of rank 1 representations, so that Fm is, well, up to a final cover. Up to a finite cover, the Fm. So I'll not change the notations to confuse even more. So Fm is a sum of line bundles, which are, of course, topologically trivial. Okay, so this is where we use the quadratic dimension zero in order to apply the result of Zuo concerning this type of representations. And then somehow, by quite a few results and work, we can infer that, in fact, each LJ torsion, which somehow ends the proof of this case, because then you can construct sections by raising this one to a high power and using that the fact that the bundles are torsion. So you construct the extension of the sections from a fiber to the whole manifold simply by parallel translation. Okay. So this is so here the dots, what is inside is the fact that is this result. See, if the we can consider the Albanese map here, and then we know that this is a surjection by a result of Kawamata, and then since the quadrature of the fiber here is zero, then the direct image of the canonical of Y will be trivial. And this combined with a few results of Simpson concerning the Green-Lazarsfeld sets in a pluricanonical version of those will give you the fact that the bundles here are torsion. And then, so again, with this, the first case would follows. And then, the next, then we consider the case of where the quadrature of Y is at least one, and then what we do is to consider the integral vibration of Y. So we have the map here from X to Y, and then let's say that this is P, this is pi, and then we get the map F like this. So let's assume the real story is a bit more delicate, but let's assume that pi is a holomorphic map. So this is the Ithaca vibration corresponding to Y, which for the purpose of this talk, let's assume it smooth. Regular. Let's assume that Z is smooth. So all those can be achieved by changing the model, by taking a blow up of Y. But then a few things go wrong, and it's a bit longer story than what I will tell you next. So here, then what we do is to consider now a general point here. So Z and then the quadrature of YZ equals to zero, okay? And then, thanks to my assumptions, and then the map, so I consider the fiber, the map, the restriction of the map from between the fibers of F and pi, so XZ to YZ. So this So P restricted to XZ. Now this one still has the same property, the push forward of the pluricanonical relative pluricanonical bundle is trivial, and Kodairov of this one of the target is zero. So this means that the Kodairov XZ by the case which we already discussed is greater than Kodairov the fiber. So somehow what I'm trying to explain to you is that we have a section on the defined on the fiber. Well, we cannot extend it to X all the way, but at least we can extend it on the fiber XZ of this map. So now let's see how we go from XZ to X. So we have the following. So we have the following lemma. Let's say if V is in H naught of XZ and M times KXZ over YZ, then the norm of V square exponential minus phi relative X over Y. So then the sup of this quantity over XZ is bounded. So the norm of the section V with respect to the metric we cook up here is bounded. So again, this metric is switch the notations here. So the metric here is writing the nth power of this one as an adjoint bundle, right? So what is the idea of the proof of this? So you see, somehow this would be, if I would have written the same statement for a fiber or for a general fiber of this map, then the assertion is absolutely immediate, because the metric I have here, this is what it does. It takes into account all the sections from the fiber. But here the point is that the singularities of the map P may map surjectively into Z. So fatally, some of the fiber XZ may, so excuse me, some of the YZ will intersect that the singularities of the map. So this is somehow the difficulty. So the main proof that what I want to say here is that the main idea of the proof is that so we consider a flat frame of FM. So again, this this we can do, because we already know that the guy here is flat. So that this means that the integral of xy of flat frame, let's say uj of uj square exponential minus m minus 1 times the phi m, this is a constant with respect to y. Okay, so the norm of those sections are constant with respect to the point. And then by the definition of the metric we have here on the m tensor power of the relative canonical, phi relative is greater than the logarithm of the norm of uj divided by this quantity at each point. So here I have x, and here at the point y, where y is the projection of x. So somehow this implies, well, maybe square. So somehow this implies that the uj square exponential minus phi relative is less than the norm of uj square. So here I have a pointwise quantity. Here I have the L2 norm, which I mark here. And somehow the good news is that this function is constant. It doesn't depend on the point of the base. So this is exactly what allows me to extend the sections that I have on the fiber. So you see, it's really crucial to have this flat structure on FM, because if not, the quantities I have here, it's very hard to control, very hard to understand, as y approaches the singular loci of the map. Now, once we are at this point, then so as you know, the why we can extend the section from xz to x all the way is that when we write, so we will have the omega x twisted with the boundary here, x over y, let's say tensor m, and tensored with the inverse image of omega y. So this one will, to some sufficiently large power, but which is fixed, m0, this one will carry the positivity in the direction of z, in z directions. Okay, so this is the Ithaca map. So the bundle here is the inverse image of some ample and big bundle on z. So this is why we get the positivity on this one, on the inverse image. Here, I already have a metric, which is the one cooked up here. And the sections I'm interested in, they are L2 with respect to the metrics I have here and there. So then this will follow by usual L2 theory. By L2 theory, we can extend the sections V. Well, not exactly the section V. You have to adjust it a little bit to have it become a section of those restricted to XZ. But somehow this is the idea. Why we win is because of the flat structure on the direct image. Okay, so very, very quickly, what is happening? So somehow this is a very rough outline of the proof in the case of the collider dimension at least one. Now, for the maps on surfaces, so the dimension of S equals 2. So the only case to be still to be considered is where S equals K3 surface. The rest of them are, well, of course, we are Junior and Cao is using the classification of surfaces, and then the general type are settled since a long time. then there is a little argument for elliptic surfaces, but probably the most subtle part concerns the K3 surfaces. And then what is happening here is that when we consider the direct image of the determinant, well, direct image of omega x over s tensor m, then the determinant of fm. So one can use the Zariski decomposition for this one. So this decomposed as like sum of, let's say, aj cj, plus some LM. And then again, here, so this is contractible and this is semi-ample. And somehow the good news, the good thing is that on the surfaces, the abundance conjecture is proved. You have many good properties because of that. The point is that here the crucial case to be analyzed. The crucial case to be analyzed is when the proof goes by analyzing the numerical dimension of this bundle, which is 0, 1, or 2. So 2 is absolutely immediate because the determinant of Fm would be big, and then this is something existing in the literature. 1 is still accessible with this kind of tools. But then the case where the numerical dimension is 0, and this one being semi-ample, would tells us that this is trivial. Then this is the case which is a bit more complicated, and then so in particular the determinant of Fm is just equivalent with this. So those CIs, this is a contractible curve, and somehow the important fact is that when we contract those curves by a result of Campana. Now the pi one in the set, so this one to start with would have orbifold singularities, because again this one is a K3. And then the fundamental group in orbifold sense here is almost abelian, and this is an important information given that we want to construct sections by a parallel translation, parallel transport. So if you know that something about such information about pi 1, this is how the proof is structured by using this information. Okay, so I think I'll stop here, and thank you.
Questions for Mihai? Okay, tomorrow the first talk will be